So is this like the third recording?
This is the 15th recording. And of which this is Darkest Dungeon. I am Griff Hoffman, and with me is Gene Severed Jr. Mm. This is a video for Boss Bear
Come on, Bailey, you can do this.
Okay, thank you. This is a video for Darkest Dungeon stuff. Let's play right now before we destroy it once again.
Okay, let's go to fun, because that sounds fun.
Let's go to fun.
In Fun Town, where everything looks super nice here and repaired, and there's a little spooky thing in the background. Don't worry about that.
Fine.
It's not dark. And then you get to Hobo Town.
Let me share with you.
Got a hole there, got a hole there, and a broke-ass thing here. So yes, this is your town where all a lot of important things happen. So these three buildings, Abbey, Sanitarium, Tavern, Stress Relief. That's super important. We'll get to that later. Then you have the Guild and the Blacksmith, which is also super important because that makes your character stronger. You'll notice that everything is super important because this game is really unforgiving.
And speaking of unforgivable, what we kind of did here with this was throw Gene into a game that I've already been playing for a little while. To see how he's going to respond to that. Him being an expert on all video games ever.
I don't know about that.
He is going to kind of jump in medias res for my campaign. And let's see what happens.
Ooh, this is going to be interesting. We're gonna have lots of fun here. So we are going to... Wait a minute. No.
So what he's looking at right now is some of the skills, like you get companions that are allowing you to do dungeon crawling, and they have special abilities and skills and whatnot. So he's mousing over their abilities to, you know, essentially function as a party. And as time goes on through this video, he'll kind of tell you a little bit more about their spacing that's important and their abilities that are important and everything that come along with that. So. What are you doing right now?
That's a blacksmith. Once your characters get to a certain level, you can upgrade your blacksmith by collecting these various deeds, emblems, boosts, and portraits to increase the ability which you can upgrade your own characters. So I see that you've already put one level weaponsmithing, so right now I'm like, okay, let's put him in there. I can upgrade him to level 1, which increases his damage and base stats, which is insanely important in this game.
Mm.
So I intend to take the bounty hunter so I can upgrade his attack. That's definitely a good thing. We don't have enough... Wait a minute. We might actually be able to wiggle our way into something here. So you can exchange things for other things. I'm saying things a lot.
So essentially you get like trinkets from crawling the dungeon, and those things are resources that allow you to upgrade your town. You can use those to pump into different places in the town that allow you to boost up your character's abilities. But what Gene's doing right now is exchanging one resource for another, which I had no idea about until 5 seconds ago.
Bruh. So right now, Griff's got some... Oh, you got that level 2? That's good. That's a really good one.
What do?
Oh, the pain.
What do?
I don't know what you're saying, bruh. I'm going to spend a bunch of money to upgrade the healing abilities because those are super helpful.
Yeah.
That's crud. Judgment is super good. So this person, I'm upgrading a lot of her skills because she is going to be a center point of me not dying. That's the best one.
Pain null.
All right. So that's the good part.
I had pain null once.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Did it hurt when it passed?
It did.
So let's embark on an adventure.
So the course of this game is, besides just the homestead building, is dungeon crawling. And in order to crawl a dungeon, you need a party. So right now, Gene is going to investigate my party members that I've had in my kind of stable and see what are feasible, looking at their skills and their positioning and all that stuff. Because as you can see right now on the bottom of the screen... there's kind of like an order in which he's putting them in, and that is critical because certain characters can function well in certain areas of the order based on their abilities. A nice quick like Cliff Notes version of it is if you see the preferred position right under the combat screen, he's mousing under it right now, like you can see those yellow dots being like where are they best functional. So if you're going to design a party, you may want to be be cognizant of those things where your team would be best suited to.
Hit the nail on the head there.
Hey!
So, something I wanted to kind of demonstrate, you have up to, what is it, six? Seven skills. You can only have four at a time. But if you look at these little buttons, it's the preferred position of your character and the preferred target. So each of these abilities has a certain area where you have to be within the party to use it, and then the target area of the where you can cast the spell and have it affect a creature.
Right.
So you have to be in the first two positions, and you have the ability to hit the first two positions of your enemy. So if you look at these while I select abilities, it changes. So she's a very strong person in position one and two. Right. I think that's three and four. I can't remember.
Good in the back.
So that is probably my setup here, actually. Yeah, I'm going to keep that. That's a good one.
Yeah. So like you said, a character can only have so many abilities. So you can't just, like, max out your character to be a supreme jester. They have to be a person that is, like, the jester that you want to roll with based on their abilities.
Wait, what am I missing here? Flashbang? Yeah, we'll be fine.
And there's a gajillion different class types that have different skills and different, like, priorities and dispositions and how they want to, you know, be in the party lineup. So it makes for very cool management game that combined with, like, abilities and as she's doing right now, like, item management, how to boost those skills up versus, you know, min-maxing those situations. One of the other things you might see right there is that mask in the screen underneath quirks, as there's some flashing and colored and or left right colored words that would sorry man, like my job has got me really concerned about what do you call that? Color
coordination?
No, not color. Yes, very color coordinated. What is it when you can't see colors?
Colorblind?
Yeah, colorblind. Like, I have to be very cognizant about colorblind stuff. So things on the left versus things on the right by the quirks thing.
So the color really only makes a difference because it's like, okay, common, very rare. So these trinkets boost...
Oh, I was saying the face thing. Like by quirks, like right here.
Oh, okay, faded and fragile. So left side positive, right side not so good. This is something that gets really interesting later because, for instance, you get a benefit of, okay, she's a better healer while camping. She has a natural swing, so she increases her accuracy.
Also, camping is brand new to me.
Oh, dude, we're gonna do a camping.
Let's camp.
And then you have
let's
the negative.
Let's camp.
Oh man, I have a really bad joke. Anyways, so then you have like the negatives where you can like scattering. -5% damage on range skills. So you get like a bunch of positives, a bunch of negatives, and they kind of balance each other out. The trinket system in this game I find actually really fascinating and really cool, where many of the trinkets increase a positive aspect but lower a door. So this item right here increases damage versus unholy by quite a bit, but he ain't going to dodge a damn thing.
Right.
So same deal here. Like this. Oh, it increases your ability to scout and your ability to disarm traps, but it reduces your speed, which I need to actually put that on somebody else.
Right. So I'll take over the narrative here for a bit while Gene gets set up and goes into this thing. I had a very cool run the other day in which my party... So if you're familiar with, like, you know, any kind of RPGs or anything... You would think, like, I want to have a balanced party. I want to have somebody who can heal. I want somebody who can tank. I want somebody who can, you know, do damage. That kind of a thing. Like, that's your standard trifecta. Like, do those three things, and you'll manage a crowd control. Those are the kind of big three things. So I ran into a situation where it's like, let's just all go balls to the wall damage. And I didn't actually know that's what I was running into. And I did. And it was all damage. And somehow I came out of it successfully. So that was very exciting. But like he's saying, you know, you have to manage that stuff very carefully because this game is punishing. And I got really lucky. in that I was able to kind of force my way into full damage onslaught and get through it. But Darkest Dungeon does not abide by those rules. Like, it is like, oh, you think you just want to, like, brute force your way through this?
Nope.
No. No. Make a smart party. So, Gene has probably made a smart party at this point. So what have you done right now?
So, right now, we don't really have a solid tank, but we have a good mixture of damage and healing ability. You have the Jester, which has some bleed attacks as well as some general melee. You have the Bounty Hunter, which has the ability to mark targets to increase damage, as well as he does a pretty strong amount of damage output, but they're not necessarily the tankiest of individuals. I've supplemented that by creating a damage over time individual who has the ability to heal as well as reduce damage input, and then the solid healer here who can, you know, make sure everybody somewhat stays alive. Now, this is probably going to be fairly rough regardless. Mm. So we're going to go for a medium, which means you see this little one here. That means you have one camping. We have to exploring 90% of the rooms.
Yeah, so camping is bonkers. Darkest Dungeon, this game came out last year. It has changed significantly. All your team doesn't die all the time, which is very nice, but you have to deal with a lot of more interesting systems. So with the camping, your team members have like a subset skill in which you can camp and you can, you know, spend a night, you know, kind of using your skills to do different things. It's very cool, and we'll probably see that in this run here. But difference from the previous is camping was like a late game thing where you would never really deal with it, and it was kind of like, oh, mandatory, there's no success on things. So now what we're gonna do is jump into a mediocre dungeon and kind of see what happens, and hopefully get some exposure to what is Darkest Dungeon.
So this is actually as mundane as it is, one of my favorite parts. It's the preparation area. So since it's a medium-sized dungeon, you get a piece of wood, which you'll use to camp at some point during the dungeon. Right. Then you buy your provisions. One, food. You need food. If you don't have food, it's a huge stress penalty, as well as you lose life. You have other items to get that help you throughout the Explorer. Now, depending on which character classes you choose, you get just automatic benefits. So if you have, I believe the Vestal automatically has medicinal herbs, so I already had one of those. The Plague Doctor will have an antivenom as just for being in the party. I picked up an extra one of each because they serve various purposes throughout the dungeon. Then you have a shovel, which helps you clear impediments, which is an enormous...
It will destroy your party if you don't have that.
Yeah, like, it makes a huge impact if you run into an obstacle and you don't have a shovel.
Again, I'm speaking from the early game where everything would destroy you.
Now, keys are super, super subtly important. Where when you find certain treasures within the game, if you don't have a key, you either get hit with a trap or you just get a really mundane reward. But if you have a key, you get a massive return on your investment.
So let's play.
All right, let's do it. And torches are important. Holy water, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, yeah. No, sorry to cut you off there, but...
Bruh.
You taught me a lot last time we played, and my run was really, really fun after you explained everything. From when the game launched to current, I've had a gajillion hours more enjoyability.
Yes, we got a scouting chance.
Also, I learned a lot of the cool tips about how to like min-max and you know, deal with that prepping phase. So now let's turn it over to Gene for how to deal with the dungeoning phase.
So insider tip, if you ever get any item that increases your chance to scout, bring it. It is it's infinitely important, because then you scout, you say, okay, look, I have a random curiosity here, and there's a trap. It's enormously beneficial. Curiosity, some random thing.
That's your getting portraits or things that will help increase your estate, right?
Or is it different? They're just curiosities, so they can be anything from a statue or whatever. So let's check this out. This is a statue. Hopefully nobody has kleptomaniac. Okay, good. So certain negative effects, you have people that automatically interact with some kind of object.
Very bad.
It can be a massive pain in the A. So now, a statue generally has a beneficial effect if you use holy water. So let's find out. So hey. He got a fat buff. He he's doing a hell of a lot more damage because I use the holy water. Now, it could have given that benefit even if I did not have the holy water, but it's guaranteed with the holy water instead of like,
oh, there's
okay,
a trap.
And there's a trap. So, bye-bye trap.
So that's the kind of crazy thing about this game is you as a player can also literally move through the dungeon slower and be more cognizant of where you're walking and be aware of the things your mouse is going over to aid yourself in the dungeon.
So I don't know what the... Because each random curiosity that you run into requires some random object down here to make it be a positive effect or at least a neutral effect. I don't remember what the books are, so...
The books!
Let's do it.
Hey!
Hey! So yeah, but the traps are actually a very, very important thing.
So, not to interrupt, but that was actually a beneficial. So she got this effect, which increases her scouting chance in a certain particular area. Mm. Most times you'll get punished with a not beneficial effect. So that was a lucky hooray for me.
Nice. But to continue, where is that?
You should explain the torches.
Oh, yeah. No, you do it.
So the torches... As you progress through the dungeon, your torchlight begins to diminish. So right now, it gets an improved chance to dodge, improved chance to scouting, and you have a massive chance to improve the actual surprising the monsters. Now, as the torch... Oh, see, this is why you need food, otherwise I would have been punished big time for this.
I did too.
So...
Was a food check early, man. Like, I never got that before. That's mean.
This is a medium dungeon, baby. Buckle up. So, as the torchlight diminishes, it has interesting effects. It reduces your chance to surprise... It reduces your chance to surprise the monsters, but it also increases the chance for loot, increases your stress, so there's... It's like a give-take. The safe route is to always keep your torch super high.
Right. But you also don't... Yeah, exactly. Like you said, it's in your benefit to have the torch high.
Unless you're a ballsy motherfucker.
Right.
Because as the torchlight gets slower, your rewards get much greater.
So what are you doing on the bottom screen there? You're selecting the route through the dungeon?
This is the...
Next route, let's talk about that.
Exactly. So you basically plot your course by selecting on the room as you get to the room, and then you have inventory because if you keep clicking on this damn torch...
The match is struck.
Ooh. You could also click on the torch in the center, top center.
What?
You can click on that. It'll relight your torch.
This is why we have a shovel.
That's right.
Even the cold stone seems better.
You dug it out?
Oh my god, it did not use the shovel.
Why'd you do that?
Because apparently it's been too long since I played this damn game.
So that is the deficit of clicking the shovel.
Hey, we got a fight.
Or not the shovel. But, as Gene said, have a torch out. Have your wear and time, because then you have a higher chance of surprising an enemy, which is really good. You can see that in the stats. So now we're in battle. So I'm going to take a back seat here, and Gene, you want to just describe what you're doing here?
Yeah, right now I'm... Oh, nice. So each character has like unique abilities. So you notice that the plague doctor threw a poison grenade and hit both of them. So both of them are basically poisoned.
Mm-hmm.
So this person has 4 hit points left. Poison's going to do 4 damage per round. So when it takes his action, he's dead. So fuck him.
Right.
Now, it's these characters in the back. They don't do a lot of damage, but they raise your stress.
Yes.
Which, for Mr. Plague Doctor, is really bad now.
Yeah.
So we're going to go focus on trying to either stun or kill this dude. Which, luckily, we have a good chance to stun. What? Oh, I can't hit the bat guy. Okay, so instead we're going to judgment him and try to just do damage to him.
So once again, those pits and things.
That motherfucker dead. Wish we got a crit. Carry on, Griff.
Oh no, those pips are important. The management of your characters and your team are very important. How they're laid out. Jesus Christ, you're just crushing through these people.
This is a super easy fight. I mean, the only thing that's rough is those two bad guys. They can raise your stress to be something ridiculous.
Yeah, and surprise was very nice, and you dealt with that extremely well. We'll probably see more on this, and essentially that is the base level of how combat works. It's all about managing... not only turn order, but position order in a battle.
It's also... Yes! Come on, secret room!
Oh, don't tell me there's some fucking Binding of Isaac stuff here in this.
No, secret rooms are incredibly beneficial.
Okay.
Which hopefully we'll get one in this video here.
So after you get to a room, you select your next room, and then you move on, and you disarm the trap because you can see things on your game.
Wait, what the hell do I need to use on this bookcase? Okay, I don't know what I need to use, so just read some stuff. Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, so
we have a fight coming up here soon.
The path is clear. We require only the
torch because I want some inventory space. Because you notice that your inventory space starts super full, but it whittles down.
Yeah.
This is going to be an interesting fight.
All right, you got a lot of flesh. You got fleshies and you got skeletons.
So the biggest issue is going to be this thing right here. It has a very high chance of doing like massive stress damage, which I really can't afford him to get stressed because then he'll act like an asshole during combat.
Right. Stress is a tough thing. Stress is one of the things in this game that really brings it to another level from your standard RPG, where your team members, yes, can do damage and can absorb damage and be repositioned and whatnot. But as you just saw with those white, black, negative buffs, you're also dealing with another resource, which is stress.
And,
if a character gets too stressed, as you can see with the guy with the beak, if you get too stressed, then things can go awry. It's a very interesting, different mechanic to deal with. And if they get too stressed, they can freak out. Or also make really amazing, cool actions. But the latter is less probable. So undoubtedly, we'll probably see what happens here through this dungeon. Stress is a very complicated thing to do with this game. It's going to be fun to see how we go.
Indeed, Mr. Purple.
Bah!
So, I'm... Nope, I'm going to be ballsy.
What you got? Oh, I was going to ask you. What's your thought process?
Yeah, crit. So whenever you critic attack, you really reduce your stress. So that's a super side benefit there, which, dude, the bounty hunter is balling out
of
control.
Dodging.
Damn.
Yeah.
But this dude's dead. He's got poison. He's screwed.
Right. So, don't attack him.
Absolutely not. So that guy's dead, too. So let's just wreck
it.
I can't do it. All right, we'll just drag him to the front. Bring it on, baby.
Goodbye. Even though he is already a front-attacking dude.
That was actually probably a less than good idea.
But also that actually made sense in the situation.
That's not good there. That actually stunned my jester.
Now we're fine.
I'm just going to beat this dude like he owes money. Have fun being stunned.
This is how life is taken.
So let's do... Wait. Oh, I forgot to switch his ability. Whatever. So we're going to go ahead and remove that disease thing. Or bleed, so he stops taking damage, which it may have already worn off. I wasn't paying too much attention. So now, since we only have one dude, this is the perfect time to start healing your group and make sure they don't die.
But I will caution you, Gene.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of was in that same thought process the last time I was playing this. If you kind of stall and make a smart game where you're like, I'm just going to debuff this enemy and rebuff my characters and continue to heal and whatnot, they will summon something that will F you up. And they will pull in things to make the match more complicated. It will not just be, here, enjoy this easy battle. They will make the enemy, the AI of the game, will make it more complicated. So you just don't have the freedom, like, oh, you won. So just like Gene did there, you want to end this match in a reasonable amount of time. Otherwise, the game will punish you intensely.
And not only that, your actually own party members will start throwing a temper tantrum about it, where you'll start taking additional... Good God. That's so much stress.
Yeah.
You know what? The hell with it. We're going to do it. We're going to camp right here, which is super early.
Hmm.
Let's do it. So this is why it's always a good idea to bring extra food. Zero food? Man, that really sucks.
That's bad.
Half? Okay, it's a give take. Full? Okay, you get some extra HP. But see that stress?
Yes.
That's massive.
Right. This is brand new to Darkest Dungeon in this year. Previously, this did not exist.
So now you have the beauty of each of your characters has a skill that's beneficial while camping.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So bandage, you heal. Right now I'm going to look for things to reduce Captain, Plague Doctor's stress levels here. So what's this? Okay, we're going to do that anyway, so that's super useful. Yep,
Mockery.
We're doing that.
Wait, what?
All companions, 20 stress. One companion, 20... Okay, sorry. You're good, bro.
Nice, hit him. Good.
Oh, dude, the Jester. I forgot how much of an amazing camp bro he is.
Yeah, Jester's great. Even before the game got all the buffs, the Jester was one of my favorite characters to play as, because you could just keep him in the back party, and he would just keep your sanity at a check. He was like a healer. He was a sanity healer. Mm-hmm. But now they really retooled it to make him more viable in different directions.
So now hopefully we won't have to deal with the most irritating damn thing I ever have to deal with in this, is a surprise attack during the sleep.
Yeah.
So let's find out. Oh, thank God.
We're good.
In Radiance, may we find victory.
Sorry, I thought we were going to get attacked, so I took a drink of my beer. I mean, water. So let's go here. So that's...
While we're futzing around with this dungeon, each dungeon has a different goal in it, right? So we're not just trying to explore the whole thing.
Oh, these dudes are fudged.
Oh, yeah. We're trying to either explore some of it or find something critical in this area. You know, it's not just like loot every nook and cranny.
It's a mixed bag of nuts. It's not necessarily that each dungeon area has a different goal. It's that the goals between all the dungeons vary greatly, but each dungeon area generally has a certain type of monster.
Mm.
Now, that doesn't mean that, hey, I'm in the ruins, so I'm only going to fight skeletons. It's you have a higher likelihood of fighting skeletons, but you'll still run into those damn bandits.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a mishmash, so you get a little bit of everything.
Yeah. Hit your torch. Yeah.
Let's bust that torch out, baby. Empty room. I really wanted to find a secret room because those are super nice. And that really underlines the importance of having a key at any given time.
Mm.
Just moseying along. And we're about to get into a fight. Torch it up.
Oh.
Okay, good. We have the perfect...
Oh, wow. Good timing there.
Oh, thank you. Because these guys... Their stress business is just, it's sucky.
Yeah, the goblet of temptation.
Yeah, let's wreck both those. Oh, that was the wrong attack.
You clicked the wrong thing.
My bad.
Now we're dead.
No, we're not dead, but that's kind of shitty.
Jesus.
He is going to die. Oh, I can't hit him. But I can be a dick to him. Come hither. So now he can't do his stress attack. Bye. Did they reduce the difficulty even further? Because I don't remember this being this easy. Because I'm landing attacks. I'm not getting ambushed every 2 seconds. Like this is nice.
Based on how well I was playing the other day and having a great time with this, yeah. I can understand how it's gonna get harder as time goes on, but when you start playing, I feel like it's letting you understand the game quickly and not just gonna mess you up. So,
which honestly is probably a good thing because, oh my god, is this unforgiving?
But it's also, you know, this is like 6 hours in.
Hell no,
essentially.
We're not doing that shit again.
Do it. Do it, Gene. Go back. We'll
come back to that. Right. Don't worry about it.
All right, fine. I feel like, conversely, you could play a game in Darkest Dungeon and lose in the first level. But now, you could play the game
and
not really knowing anything and still play through it and schlub your way and have a fine time.
Negative effect. There we go.
Oh.
Now he's a... What the hell is that? 20 stress if HP is below 50. Well, that sucks.
Right.
That sucks a lot.
But it's not like game ending. So before you'd be like, that person's dead.
Oops.
That person's trapped for death forever. It feels like, yes, you messed up, but it's not the end of the world. Like, it's a bad run here on this dungeon, but it's not a bad run for your entire time in the dungeon, which is what it kind of was before.
Yeah,
so I appreciate that metering.
Less of like, oh, you made a mistake, two of your party members dead, good luck finishing the dungeon.
Yeah, it's time to leave now, essentially.
That is why you always bring your
food. Everybody hungry.
So I think this is either 80% or close. So we just have to explore one more room and we're good. And then I'll go back to that thing and we'll explain the death that I'm about to experience.
Yes. Also, I feel like when you go back through rooms you've already explored, the torch depletes slower?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
But you also accumulate stress faster.
Yeah.
Because your bros are like, bruh, we don't go back through this room.
Yeah, that torch is looking bad right now, to be honest.
Well, I have to save that torch for the nightmare I'm about to unleash, so we'll be just fine. Don't worry about it.
Oh, okay.
It's going to be okay. Ooh, child, things are going to get...
booky.
So who do we want? Do you want the jester?
Yeah.
Come on, funny man. Read him. That sucks.
Oh, he read a Garfield comic.
Well, that didn't do anything. Yeah, I get it, bro. See, right? To see how the torch at half... we start getting better loot.
It's also much more...
but monsters are angrier.
Punishing.
Which, even if... I think this is it. So we win... We could leave the campaign.
We win.
But... individuals like me? No, bro. We gotta get the good. We gotta get the goodies. So let's do it.
Continue. Oh, he's going down there.
What?
Holy gosh.
Oh, God.
Everybody's hungry.
Thank God I have 2 food left. Hey! Food torch! Oh, dude, in a ruby? Hell yeah! Alright.
Hit that torch.
But that's gonna be... you know what? Hang on, was it shift? Let's do it. Secrets I guarantee you there's gonna be a fight in this room. In the most tenebrous corners of this place. Okay, I'm a liar.
Ooh, so what you did right there was try to go down to 0 on darkness on the torch.
So, see that loot plus 3-3?
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Let's do it. Let's go over here.
Let's roll the dice, Amorephers. Watch out for them traps.
It's kind of spooky because I don't know if I'm going to run. All right, let's open
this books!
Hey, there's a map inside, which didn't do...
moving.
Come on, secret room. Hey, there's treasure and a battle. We're going to be fine. We're totally going to be fine.
Don't get ambushed.
In fact, we are going to have you eat some food.
So you can also use food... in the meantime, for just basic heal-ups, which, if you're a noob like me, you're like, ah, my person's low on health, eat some food. But then, once those food prompts happen, and you'll have enough food, then your whole party gets upset. So it's very important to understand that you need to bring a lot of food into a dungeon. What Gene kind of demonstrated right here was, bring a bunch in, and then if you're going to crawl later, be smart about it. And then as we saw just there a moment ago, that was like that status effect, which, and right there too, which hits your psyche and makes you crazy. Death waits. Oh, everybody's sad. The slightest
lapse. That's right. I think we'll be good crushing these dudes.
Okay.
You know, I just want him to die because I don't want to deal with stress.
So stressed right now.
Ah,
oh, nice.
That's a funny joke you missed, nerd.
Ah!
Alright. Well, he's done for.
Mm-hmm.
That guy might be an issue. Let's just get rid of this turd. Here, catch. Oh, wrong one. Here, catch. Oh, he missed, but he got... he resisted the blight?
Oh, resisted it.
That's a joke. Okay, that's really not good.
Oh, boy. We're stressed out right
now. So he's got...
oh, all right. Goodbye. That guy's dead still, so we're doing
please
right.
Be the vegetable's turn.
Okay. So doing
so that
damage,
attack also switches
down.
His position, which can be super helpful later. And goodbye. Oh, yeah! Another abomination cleansed from our lands. For the love of God, heal. Heal like super killer.
6 is good. 6 is good.
It's a max.
This is very much like a classic D&D thing, too, where you're like...
it's
4 heals. Amazing!
Yeah.
We'll take it! Instead of, like, 600. So that's really cool.
That is nice. It's like, low numbers, so you're not having to worry about, like, okay, I need to get 6,000 hit points to not get murdered.
Right. It's really cool, because if you're playing the game, you're like, I got something to heal somebody 1 HP. Well, that's actually good.
I brought way too many keys. Alright, so. Nonetheless. A chest with a famous signal. Let's drop a key in there and see what happens.
Hey.
Oh, we get more treasure.
Yeah.
Wealth beyond
actually,
measure.
That's not bad. So we are really full. So let's get rid of this, and actually, hang on a minute, what do you got here? Somebody's got an open spot. There, you can hang on to that right there. And now, come on, find a secret room.
Oh my god, we found a secret room!
Let's do it. Alright, I was gonna say, let's kill ourselves on the Cthulhu room.
Well, we're just gonna be hungry now.
Oh, everybody. So when you're hungry, everybody takes damage and also
a ton of stress.
It's very stressful because food's great.
This right here is why you always want to have an extra key. And I'm about to show Griff some hilariousness.
Okay.
So we've been collecting gold, like, oh, 1,750. That's great. That's super great.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, a chest, ancient artifact. Oh, it's a locked component on the side of it. Mm-hmm. Behold.
Okay, we got it.
Okay, so 1,750, right?
Uh-huh.
5,000, or 3,500.
Holy
ballsack. So... Goodbye. We'll take the important things, and boom, you are rich now.
Wow.
I have to go fight the angry thing?
No. Yes.
Man.
I mean, what are we at here? How much time are we at? 36 minutes?
Can we just... We can go engage it, and then we'll just run the hell out of there.
Is that possible? Oh, we're so hungry, though.
Hang on, I think somebody's losing their mind here.
Yep.
Okay, hey, we get to see somebody's resolve. Oh, damn it.
Oh, that's a bummer.
It's the Jester? Oh, God, we have three people at 100 stress. Okay, these are a bunch of negative effects. This isn't good.
All right, well, I was bogarting the good effects early.
Hey, we got focused.
Hey.
What the hell does focus do? He doesn't tell me.
He's good now. Everything's fine now.
All right, okay, we're going to try and get there. Wait, I have an extra torch so we can stave off some of the anger.
Oh, Jesus.
Injury and despondence. Set the stage for heroism.
Oh boy.
Yes, sir. Let's do it.
So, I'm about to show you something you should never, ever do at a lower level.
Right, which also means my safe Aldis is burnt to the ground.
Well, we're going to engage this thing, we're going to hit it a couple times, and we're going to run the hell away.
Okay.
Actually, we have a fight between there and now.
That's fine. Let's do it. Let's do it.
I don't know if we can make it, man.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Three hit points. We got five.
Let's do it.
All right, here we go. Oh, this is bad.
Here you go, faithful listeners. You're at 34, 37 minutes in. Let's do it.
Oh, hell.
Gene, this is where your prowess comes in.
Dude, this is bad.
You got this.
All right, let's try to kill him.
Stinky gas time. He's blinded. That's good.
Good. We can get him dead next round.
Okay.
You're a bad person. Right, don't have a heart attack. Oh my god, 23.
Now everybody's crazy. Doesn't matter.
Goodbye.
All right, he's dead. A
singular strike. Whoop-de-doo.
He's fine.
Please be the... Oh no.
He's all right.
He's going to be bleeding, he's isn't right. he? Yeah, he's at death's door.
He'll get out of there. Terrible
visitors. Yeah, that's not good. Reveal themselves. Oh, thank god. Griff, can you explain Death's Door while I have a panic attack?
Yeah, no problem. So Death's Door is essentially when your character has reached zero HPs, and there's essentially a dice roll that says, hey, are you super dead or not dead? So at this point, we're not super dead. We have a chance to bring them back into the living. They take major stat penalties and whatnot, a la classic D&D. So right now, this guy is still trucking along. We'll hopefully heal him up and get him right back into the fight. Well
struck. Which, if you notice there, when I went to heal the entire group, this guy was like, get wrecked. That's an effect of him being a hopeless turd.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so once you get to those...
healer's nice, making it work. Perfect.
That was one of the problems when you get down and dirty in the social space, in the mind game. You have to deal with a lot more systems. But, Gene, wreaking havoc in damage.
What?
Yeah, whatever.
Foolish horrors. Brought low and driven into the mud.
Oh my god, just... There, take that. We have room for gold?
Eat the gold. Tell the jester to eat the gold.
Yeah, just leave it. Okay. So hopefully we can live through the first round of this.
All right, here
nonsense.
We go. So we're.
Oh shit.
That was good.
Yeah, we're fine. We get it. He's dying.
We're gonna make it.
Oh, you bastard!
Are you kidding me? Right, let's get out of here.
So you're supposed to drop a torch in there, and it summons a really, really angry thing. So now we're going to leave the dungeon because we win.
Goodbye.
And I use quotation marks and win.
Goodbye.
So let's look at all the money. So the quest rewards are 4,500. Since we just found the secret room, look at all that fat money. Now this is where...
But all our teammates are dead.
They're not dead, but they're going to suffer a lot of penalties.
Oh, and also they get really cool bonuses.
So we had everybody gained a level on this. So he is going to get some kind of a stressor, and positive or negative. So let's see what it is. He's a... What the hell is that?
Lycanthropia.
So he's afraid if this torch is below 26. So whatever.
All right.
Come on, good stuff.
Ow.
Mercurial, -5 virtue chance, which means diddly.
Balls.
So, darkest dungeons. Darkest dungeon.
Dungeon's darkest.
Women and men, soldiers.
Oh, wow.
So
we did it.
Six more recruits than usual.
That was exciting. Corpses. That was a very good run. We didn't fall into the Cthulhu's grasp. Now that the road we got a lot of new folks who want to join us.
Shitload of new folks.
For some fun at the Fun Estate. They want to come to the Fun Estate. They want to have some fun at the Fun Estate.
It's a circus of fun!
That was an amazing run, Gene. Thank you for guiding us through it. This game has been out for a year.
Some DLC
by Red Hook, I believe.
Yes, Red Hook.
And it's getting ported to all sorts of systems: iPad, Nintendo Switch, on PC. I don't know if it's potentially on current or like PS4, Xbox One stuff. But yeah, it is a great game that really is like towing the line between classic D&D stuff and also amazing, super fun point and click adventure things and you know,
my
adventuring.
My like short like 2-sentence summary of this game is it's a really fun, amazing, crawling and rewarding game when you accomplish those things until the end where it gets insanely punishing. But I mean, if that's the kind of game where you build up this perfect party, you get the perfect trinkets and you build the perfect things and you still struggle, man, this is the game for you. Me, I enjoyed everything up until the very last bit of this, which there's a part of me that I'm going to finish it at some point, but it's a really great game. It's really dynamic and interesting, and there's so much variety in your party. There's so much variety in their skills. There's so much variety in their camping. There's an immense amount of variety where it's probably the closest thing to like traditional D&D to a video game I can think of.
It reminds me a lot of like XCOM, but very much in the
less
here
dumb.
And now. But like XCOM meets D&D, where it's like, do this one run right now, you good? No, okay. So yes, exactly like you said. Darkest Dungeon's very cool. Thank you for showing it. What's that in the background?
Ooh, hang on a second.
What
this?
What that? Right there?
What that? That's the damn right Darkest there? Dungeon.
Ah!
Well, hang on. Oh, hang on a second. We're putting him in the brothel.
Commit.
And nice. That's a good note to leave this on, because
nice.
Venice is getting it, baby.
Venice.
There's little pillows and sheets.
You got it. Good night, Venice. Good night.
His name is Venice? It is Venice!
Venois?
No, dude, that's French for penis.
Good night. Benoit?
Oh, thank you for allowing me the opportunity to play this video game. I'm Gene Sofer Jr., who is totally sober right now.
Also sober... Griff Hoffman, thank you so much. This has been great playing this game. Darkest Dungeon for Boss Barrel. Play this game. It's super fun.
It is super fun. Totally worth it.
Goodbye! Don't die in a dungeon.